everybody. Good morning and welcome back to Reaper Pro Tips. This is Anne, and also joined by disembodied hands, voice, head, something, spirit. Disembodied people are also here to help us, John and Justin and Quindy. So thank you all for showing up. And of course, the leaf blower started up right when I started my stream. So I may have to go over and close the window. So give me a second. Today is going to be, I don't know, I was probably going to try some freehand. One second, let me close my window, guys. The leaf blower is very loud, and then I have to turn on my fan because I no longer have a window. There we go. There we are. Yo, everybody. Okay, cool. So let me take a look at this model here for a second. I double checked our glass bottle with a Kirill glass bottle, by the way, and we did it right. Oops, let's get ourselves in focus. We are unfocused. We're fuzzy today. We're extremely fuzzy. The outlook is very fuzzy. Try again later. So we've got a couple of things that we still need to do on this model. We have to do our metal. We have to do her eyes. Let's do eyes quick as a warm-up for freehand. Seems like it should be the opposite, right? And then I'm going to see if I really want to do freehand. The problem with doing such a nice job on all of the red is that I'm loath to interrupt it with freehand. But I could try out my freehand pattern on the blue thing here, which definitely needs something. So we'll do that. We'll do our eyeballs first, though. So let's see here. We want off-white for that. You seldom want to do eyes in pure white, only the tiniest eyes, and even then it tends to look artificial. So pure white is fine as a highlight for eyes to show that they're wet if you're working on a bust. In fact, it's kind of a necessary part of doing a realistic bust if you're doing realistic eyes. But the whites of the eyes are actually not white, which you will see if you look at your own. So when you make them white, pure white, it tends to look wrong. So what we'll do is we're going to squeeze out some brown liner just for correcting in case we make a blorf. And we're going to take a tiny bit of that brown liner and put it in our white. You could also use something like leather white, which is an off-white, a grayish off-white. I used to be famous for this red, Carly. Back when I was first painting, people loved this red. I don't do it very much anymore, mostly because I haven't been, you know, painting a lot of things that are red. And the last thing I painted that did have red was Soldier, and he had a brighter red. So I just haven't been painting vampires or evil sorceresses or anything like that lately. So my old 9-layer red hasn't been getting a workout. All right, let's get this white going on. Tiny bit, just taking a tiny bit of brown liner and adding it to this white. Just going to make it go kind of grayish brown off white, which is perfect. It's still much brighter than almost everything else on the model, except for the highlights on the shiny objects, which is perfect. You don't want it to be as bright as the highlights on the shiny objects, like I said, unless you are working on a large model where you want very, very naturalistic eyes and you need that bright white light reflected highlight. There. Yeah, you could do corn. I tend to think of this more as like a world eater's corn than a traditional straight up corn, because you keep it so dark at the root of it. You've got to keep it so dark. But corn is totally within the realms of what you would do. Alrighty, got our brown liner and our off-white, and I'll probably grab some walnut for her iris and pupil. Zen Bacon, it's because if we did eyeball white, it'd just be really close to leather white. Or linen white. You could use either. Leather white is probably a little bit better. But for bigger eyes, you actually want to start with something more like weathered stone or leather white. And then you want to highlight it with linen white because the eyeball does tend to go a little bit more creamy toward the center. But, I mean, that's the thing, right? Is like when you've got 500 colors, any color you put out is going to be very close to another color. So then you ask yourself, well, if people buy eyeball white, are they just going to stop buying leather white? Because it's really close. That's why I give you guys these recipes. But yeah, because eyeballs, the other reason you don't see an eyeball white is that eyeballs, as I just mentioned, what you use for your eyeballs is going to change according to scale. All right. Yeah, World Eaters was always the... If I was going to go corn, that was my faction. But I tend to be drawn more to Zinch and Slaanesh because I like the colors better. Colors and style. All right, so we got to get these eyeballs. And of course, they're at an awkward angle. So we're going to turn the model upside down. I've filled in the eye socket, as you can see, with a dark color. I'm using tiny brush so that I can keep a little bit of control when I'm putting in the eye as I start. I do tend to do more than one layer. I'm going to stop talking as I paint in these eyes because I'm painting on the exhale, which is what I always tell you guys to do. In order to get a more steady hand. Talking and painting tiny fine detail at the same time, not ideal. Yeah, now the Nurgle stuff's the best, Crowley, sadly. The god that I've never really been drawn to, but are nonetheless is, like, now I'm tempted to paint some of it because the models are so good. All right, I'm going to try to come in between the staff and the hair over here to hit this other eye. So many of us, so many Warhammer players use that pun regularly, Nomadzeek. Like, even 20 years ago, we were making jokes about the Fleshhounds actually being corn dogs. So, it's nothing new. Doesn't mean you couldn't do it. Just means that it's old hat. It's the old, tired, beating the dead horse joke. Be aware. And then, you know, when your corn army lost, you were creamed corn. I could go on. There are many. But corn dogs were one of the best. Yeah, I need to concentrate on eyeballs. All right, so we've got our whites blocked in. And because we did not go pure white with them, they actually look pretty good. They look pretty natural. They're not, like, super standout, which they shouldn't be. If you look at my face, even right now in the camera, like, my eyes are just kind of there. Like, they're not, you know, they're not standing out. They don't blaze white or anything like that. Even when I widen my eyes, it's like, it's not like you see a huge, like, pure white shining thing. So, like, this is what you need to incorporate into your figures. Putting a pure white in the whites of the eyes tends to make them look more staring and artificial. Yes, corn dogs. I was fighting against a corn guy most of the time because I had wood elves. So making horrible corn puns, vegetable puns, was the only way I could really defend. I did beat him once. Once out of like a year of playing. Because I switched tactics. And he wasn't ready for it. But I had to use trickery. Because chaos is always really strong. It's one of GW's most, you know, popular armies, so they always make it very strong. So, all right, so let's go to here. I'm going to grab some walnut. And the reason you use walnut, when you've got these little tiny eyes, I've said this before and I'll say it again, but you don't usually do a colored iris. It's very difficult to actually make it look like the iris is colored at 28 millimeter. There are people who manage it, but the people who manage it are usually actually redrawing the eye and artificially enlarging it so they have room for it. So it's not very... I just don't do it. I don't think it looks good. So for me... Yes, exactly, Nomad. Exactly. Like I said, there are many, many, many jokes based around it. Mostly, yeah... I don't know about Khorne Berserkers. We were playing fantasy, obviously, Wood Elves. So he was just playing, I think, a Khorne Undivided. A Chaos Undivided with Khorne in it. But yes, I lost a lot. That's because I'm not a great tactician, nor am I a great strategist. The only thing I have going for me with miniatures war games is dice karma. I tend to have lucky rolls, which usually is enough to make you not lose terribly. Well, you're talking 40K. I was in fantasy. Carly. Fantasy was actually the game I loved the most. I was never into 40K. The models didn't appeal to me as much. I liked fantasy better than sci-fi. True in my fiction and my miniatures. Alright, so I thinned it about 4-1 to get the iris and pupil in there. I'm looking at the mouth. I think I need to correct it just a little bit. I lost the line between the lips when I was doing those tusks. So I'm going to grab just some brown liner. I don't want a lot of paint. And I'm going to try to reline that area. There we go. Much better. Hi, Bryce. Alrighty. So good, 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 good. Alright, eyeballs. Although you'd never know it because you're working on a 40K project for your Golden Demons, aren't you? But yeah, I liked fantasy. I liked the old fantasy. I haven't played Age of Sigmar, so I don't know how I would like it. I just haven't. I've not been around or had a group that was interested in it. So that's really what makes me start an army, is if I have a group of friends who are really interested in playing something, then I'm excited to start something new. But right now I only have the very small amount of Eldar that I got prepped and partially painted for my last time I had a group to play. All right, so eyeballs, remember guys, come from underneath. Very little paint on your brush. About a 4-1 on the walnut here. Come from underneath so that the eyelid here can stop your brush. Exhale, paint on the exhale. Do not talk to your friends while painting eyeballs, nor lecture yourself or your cats. Concentration, exhale, paint. Go in and start with a dot. That way you can adjust it if the placement is not right. And once you have that dot, you can enlarge it as you see fit. Because then you've got your target. Once you've got your dot where you want it. Also, at this point, it's very easy to go back and paint the white over it if you get the dot in totally the wrong place. And here I've got to ask myself if I want a little bit more paint there, if I want to widen. A more narrow, smaller iris and pupil is going to make the model look more alert, angry, possibly wicked. A wider iris and pupil and bigger in relation to the white is going to make the model look more relaxed. I kind of like her giving a dirty look at whoever she's looking at, so I'm going to actually try to hit the pupil on the other side and keep it small. I'm reloading my brush a lot because I'm using a tiny brush. And I need the paint to stay wet. Once again, coming up from underneath. Putting just a little dot in there. Here I've gotten the cat eye problem, where you get a bit of your brush kind of goes like up and down and you end up with slit eyes. Otherwise, the positioning is right, so I will just take some white and try to wipe out the bottom part of that slit of the eye. You can also just repaint it if you don't have my brush control. It's not a big deal. Everybody kind of expects eyes to be a trial. Got a bit of it. Need a little more. I think I need that one a little bit more toward the center. Also, the other thing that's really hard to do on these eyes, on small eyes like this, is a catch light. I won't be able to do it on her eyes here because I'm keeping her pupils and iris small. Because everything is so tiny that if I try to put a catch light in these eyes, it's just going to wipe out the entire pupil. So know your limitations. There. Wanted to make that a little bit wider. So I could keep away from that problem. I do feel like I got my white a little high on this one eye. It's not quite as small as the other. It's a little bit bigger. So I'm going to try to correct that with brown liner by bringing in... And it's easy because it's right under the shadow of her brow. So since you've got this shadowed brow ridge here, trying to take the eye down a little bit is doable. I'm going to need more water on my brush, I can tell right now. Bryce, I did try. I did, when I was in college, before I even started playing Warhammer at the local game store, my gaming group in college ran a very short foray into Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay. A little better. Yeah, it's probably good enough there. She's kind of glaring. I like it. She definitely looks displeased. I'm okay with that. Alrighty, so we have eyeballs. Ta-da! Trying to figure out, since I'm working with browns, I think I'm going to put a little bit of a highlight on her hair. Let me grab my polished leather. And my russet brown. Because russet brown was the color I did it. But I need to add a little bit of shading. And I need to add a little highlighting. Yeah. Yeah, because everybody's so fragile. Yeah. And everything else in the world is so much more powerful than you are. The starting character classes are also amusing in Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay, or at least they were back in the day. I'm going to add a little bit of white to my polished leather because I want to make it a little more opaque. Probably going to add a little bit of my russet brown to it also, just to make sure that it matches the hair color. So there's my little dot of white. A little bit of russet brown. Drop some water in it. Grab my mixing brush to mix it up. Hey, Cookie. It's good to see you back, though. Just mixing up some colors here to work on her hair a little bit. We just did her eyes. There we go. That's not bad. And to get you an idea of the actual color that is, we'll black base down so you can see them. because when all this white is in the frame, it's hard for you to see the colors, but there's that color I mixed up. I could even add a little bit more red to it, but I think I'm going to go with that for right now. And I'll also kind of rebase coat the bone color I've got here and probably highlight it real quick since I have a color, similar color mixed up, and I can just use my off-white. Ah. Yeah, work happens. Alrighty, let's see here. I want to get some of this brown liner. Get a little bit more water in it. Want to do a little bit more shading on the hair here. Want to outline that ear. Yeah, maybe someday we'll be able to have, like, you know, role-playing games in person again. Right, Bryce? Although, I've been poking people about Paint Club in this area. And so far, things are inconsequential. Since the store they were holding it at closed. Nobody seems to be, really moving on a decision. Although, there could be a lot of discussion going on behind the scenes. It's not like I'm involved. I'm just the one, like, kind of poking people, going, hey, hey, kind of like the cat in the morning. For the local paint club, I am the morning cat. I am the, hey, hey, is there a paint club yet? Hey, hey. I'm that. Mostly because, for the first time in, like, over 20 years, I would rather not be the person running and coordinating the paint club. Hey, Aldrigo. Thanks. She's getting there. We're just working on it. She's not the best thing I've ever done, and she's not the worst thing I've ever done. She is pretty cool, as far as miniature I typically level, the level I currently paint on this stream. So I'm putting in just a little bit of stippling to get some shadows into her brown hair here. I'll put a little bit of shading right at her hairline. And I'll go over here. She's got an asymmetrical hair design, probably due to Izzy doing the art, because Izzy loves asymmetry. When you see something that's an asymmetrical design on a Reaper miniature, you can almost always thank Izzy for that. And then we can come in with this kind of polished leather plus brown plus white. Yeah, on the paint club. Would you come in for that? Like if we did like a weekend day, Bryce? Like if we at somebody's house or something? Or are you too far away? Maybe you're too far away. Like, every once in a while, obviously, not every week. Cool. Oh, no, Cookie. Yeah, that's double bad. If you can't paint, then it's bad work. Bad work! No Cookie. Tigress. Well, your work should not get a cookie. Sadly, it's getting too much cookie right now for what it's doing to your life. All right, so now I'm going to take this polished leather color, which is more like this. And I think I might want even a little bit more white in it. Although her hair is very, very soft, you can tell by the way it's poofing. It looks like she's maybe got more... She's got kind of a more African texture to her hair. The wiriness of it, the way it's sculpted. So I'm going to probably, what that means when you have that soft texture, that soft kind of wiry texture, is that you don't highlight it nearly as shiny as you do other hair. You keep your highlights softer. If the hair is black and really intensely black, you can probably stipple some lighter highlights on and it won't really hurt. But if you really look... at hair like this in nature, it tends to, because the hair is so fine and wiry and soft looking, like the texture just means you don't get really high highlights on it. I will go up a little bit on this to take to test that, just to see how it looks. I'm gonna mix up a color real quick and try to, and you want a stipple usually on these, on this. The texture is so fine you probably can't dry brush it because it's sculpted really fine. Thanks, Bobby. That's actually good though. So just little stipples, little use the tip of your brush, kind of dab your highlights on a little bit just to bring up your highlights. Yeah, not every week. Of course not, Bryce. Yeah. Technically could do that with any of these, Pendrake. But yeah, the half orc is more applicable than most. I'm going to go and add this high highlight. Again, I'm just stippling, so I'm using just the tip of my brush with very little paint on it so that it doesn't go down in the cracks and it just hits the upper surface. Just to raise up some highlights on the hair. Give it a little bit of life. Just because it won't go up as high highlights as straight hair will, doesn't mean you don't highlight it. You just highlight it a little bit lower on the brightness chain, the lightness chain, the value chain, I guess, to use the art BS term. Ah, and when you have too much paint on your brush, then your stipples get too big. Too big. And if you go too far over and you feel like you've done too much, like you've gone a little too light, you can always glaze with a little bit of brown or this highlight or a mixture of both, which is what I'm going to do. Mixing a glaze is colored water. Very much so. Morning, Davidwear. So if you feel like you go up a little bit too much, you can always drop a glaze on it and blend it in a little bit better if you feel like it went a little too far there. And then I'm going to get a new puddle of highlight that I like a little bit better and reapply. I'm just going to real lightly touch some of the very top parts of the hair. Come back around here. There we go. I'm going to grab some of this and blend this in a little bit. Her shouldn't be like a huge dark shadow here. Should be some intermediary tones. There we go. That's better. Hello, Bob and Julie. It's half work day today. We're getting dangerously close to done here. Also, since I'm working with my brown, I can finally paint the staff here If I want to, I think I'm going to use walnut and then highlight with russet. I tend to make my, and we can use the Zenith Prime as a guide here. I tend to just go dark with staves. Pardon me while I push this a little bit in. But I tend to go dark with staves because they're really just usually not that important. They'll usually have little details on them that you can pick up with accent colors. But usually the stick itself is not, like, it's just kind of there. It's just kind of smooth. You can't do much with it. So if we look, we see that it does have a highlight down the front here from the Zenith Prime. So we're going to keep that. We're going to essentially, let me see if I can just paint my russet over that and then add some further shadows. So that's going to be where the highlight goes. We can even grab a little bit of our polished leather color and add a little bit more of a highlight toward the top. Maybe take it a little bit down the staff. Oh, good. Finished a piece. Sweet. Yeah, we're going to do the whole thing, Pendrake, but I was just not going to do it all really close together because I want people to be able to get something out of it. So we have a slight shift in our audience from day to day. So eventually I'll go and I'll finish the back part, but not today. The model needs to be finished, so obviously I have to finish the back part. So it's going to end up being sold or going to Ron, one way or the other. Just going to come and block in some walnut here. There's not a lot of play or color on the bottom side here away from the light, but if you want to put in a suggestion of like russet, you can, just a little bit. I just wouldn't bring it up to a full highlight on the reverse. I'd keep your lightest highlight for the front. Crystal is like super easy. Like we could do it so fast. But I wanted to get some of the rest of this stuff kind of done since I was working with these colors today. And we've got some little kind of like decoration beads or something on the front of the staff along with the highlight. I would just paint in the highlight, ignore the little little decorative bits for now. Just paint right over them. Maybe use them to line up your highlight a little bit. Then grab your other highlight, put that down. That way you can just paint the highlight without worrying about painting around the little bits. And then go back and do the bits separately. Because they're like super easy to just hit with a small highlight once you figure out what color you want to make them. Thanks, Julie. Yeah, she's out of all the models I'm working on right now, this is my favorite. So usually when I've got a model that I like a lot, it tends to work out better than other ones. You know how that goes. Your favorite child. As artists, we try not to have favorite children, but it happens. And then those guys tend to look better than the other ones. This is also a color scheme that I've always liked, so... Bring down that light in accordance there. Well, you should go and pick yourself up one. Because the model is cool, so you should get this. You should keep her in print. Vote with your dollars. 3721. I think she's also in Bones, but I like the metal for this one because she's got some small details. All right, there we go. Alrighty, just kind of blocking in this staff, and then we can move on. I think I'll do the bone area quick. As I try to decide if I really want to freehand the bottom of this sucker. Well, I think I'll just freehand the back for today. We have plenty of time for freehand. Yeah, I remember you mentioned that, Zephyr. Just paint it. Just paint it, Nomanzeek. Bruce Lee called that closing the gap. The taking the step to marry intention to action. Something that I could certainly be better at, so... Often I let myself get too busy, too overwhelmed with busyness, and I do not take the step to close the gap and do something. I'm working on it. And on the backside here, we've got a bit more shadow. I'm probably, again, not going to go as high. I'll probably use just some russet brown. Thank you, Quindy, for the links to the model. She is really cool, and I would like to see her stay in print. She would be a fun character to play. Because you'd play her totally off-type for an orc. And in some ways, she could be totally orky, but then she could totally be, like, not orky in other ways. It would be fun. Yeah, that's what it is in my world, is half, is, well, not half orc nobles, but orc nobles. It's nice to go off type with them. All right. Gonna just kind of go in here with my brown liner and add some additional shadows to these little bits between the spirals here. Make them stand out a little bit better. Just using my brown liner for that because it's nice and thin and translucent. And I can do fine detail with it very easily. These are so small, you don't really blend your highlights or your shadows. You just want to make sure that you're shadows are dark enough to pick up the details. There, when you have very small surfaces, you really aren't blending anymore. You're just kind of like blocking in a mid-tone, a shadow, and a highlight. And the amount of the difference between those things is how well those details are going to stand out. So if I were using not as dark a color to pick out these details, you wouldn't see them nearly as well. Like, higher contrast works for you with tiny details. Because now all those little curls and those horns that are holding the crystal in place look a lot more stark. You can see them. So when I add my highlight, it's going to show up a lot better. Mix up a bone color by adding taking my off-white that I used for the eyes and adding a little bit of this polished leather. It's going to end up getting to a kind of an off cream, kind of a faded cream color, which is good for bone. There we go, in focus. Once I have that mixed up, I'm just going to apply it in little dabs where the highlights would be. Once again, this is a time for fine brush control. So, but it's just little dabs too. Key here is not to choke up on your brush. Don't hold it real tight. Some people do, they get nervous and they clamp up on their brush and that makes them shake. Get all those little ones. Not talking because I'm painting on the exhale, so I need to concentrate to hit these little tiny bits. That means stopping talking, stopping everything, no distractions, just exhaling and painting as steadily as you can. Until you get those highlights where you want them. You actually typically want your paint a little bit thicker than you'd think when you're painting highlights. Going to add some shadows right under this top there, where those little dark bits are now. Because the bottom of the crystal, the fixture here, would be casting a shadow. The back's a lot darker. Some of that. Okay, excellent. Sweet. So that looks pretty good. I'm happy with it. Almost looks bronze. Could gray it out a little more with the highlights to make it less bronzy and more bone. But I'm also pretty happy with the appearance, so if I decide I'd rather not, then cool. There we are. That's cool, tight detail. Everything currently not painted is probably going to be silver at this point, just to make it stand out a little better. Okay, I think we're good. I think we're hold on here. I have a little bit of correction I want to do. There we are. So I want to do a freehand design on the back of that. You cannot make it read from all angles, Trash. It's impossible. You have to pick dual angles. That's why people normally will only do potion vials with translucence like that, or transparency like that, when it's actually up against the model, hanging from a belt. Technically, the only reason that this works is because you have the handle on this side, so you can imply a thicker glass here. And the other side you can't see because her head is there. So the only reason this bottle works, like if it didn't have this handle here, I wouldn't have done it transparent because you can't make it read this the way it needs to. Because you always need that boundary of kind of fade out at the edge of the bottle. If you go back and watch the stream, I explain it. But yeah, you just physically can't do it and make it read from all angles. It's not possible. It'll look wrong. You are very limited as far as true transparency in this hobby, and it really needs to be up against something if you're going to make it read. Like, then you can get around it a little bit, but... yes, faceted bottles can work. Because you always can paint the lines like you have on the crystal. And you can do that consistently from all angles. And that will imply that the glass is thicker there, so you can get away with it. Alrighty, let's see here. I had some thoughts about freehand that I wanted to do on this model. Let us take our off-white and utilize it. You don't need to do underpainting in pure white. You can do it in any light color. I just like to use light colors because then it makes the freehand stand out more if I'm going to make it in like a gold or silver. When I'm going up against a dark background, you want your freehand to stand out. The difference is when you do like black lace, like we did up here or something like that. And if we did that down here on the bottom, then I'd be absolutely going black and I would have to bring in more red to make sure that my freehand stood out. We may yet do that. I would just paint it like clay. I mean, if you're going to do glass, you would do a pale blue and you'd probably highlight it with white all over Mathafile and gloss it, like you say. But do it with the pale blue and still hit your highlights with white. Like, still put some white highlights on it. Like, some paler color, because that's going to imply thicker glass. But, yeah, I mean, you can't, but you, I mean... Yeah, I don't know. The easy way to do it is just, yeah, the pale blue with the white highlight and gloss it if you want. If you're doing metallics on the rest of the model, then gloss it. It's not ideal, but in a pinch, it'll be fine. I always am amused at those questions. The reason that I seem amused at it is that doing transparency is actually a lot harder than doing NMM. So if you're trying to do, like, suggesting translucent objects, I'm like, well, why aren't you doing NMM? Because it's a lot easier than what you're trying to do. But if you have a model that's a lot of NMM, I could totally see it. Yeah, but then I would just do that. I would just do pale blue highlighted with white, and do the gloss. People, for some reason, seem to think that transparency is easier. It's actually not. There we go. Ah, okay. Thank you, Quindy. Everybody thank Quindy. Quindy is awesome. But yeah, I mean, there's definitely... When you choose between NMM and metallics, you're making a fundamental choice about the way you're going to depict surfaces on your miniature. This is why using both doesn't really work. Because you are either going to create an artificial appearance of shininess on your pieces, or you are going to use actual shininess on your pieces. And once you make that choice, you should repeat it across various subjects. So if you're, like Mathafile was just saying, if you're using true metallics, you probably just want to do a pale blue and a gloss here, you know. Right, but transparency is even more mind-boggling, Dogfather. That's my point. It's like, if somebody's willing to try transparency and wants to do transparency but thinks NMM is too hard, I'm just like, you are actually... No, no. Transparency is much harder. NMM has simple basic rules, and transparency is like, it depends. I'm just doing some touch-ups here. I painted the little studs in with walnut or brown liner. I don't remember which one I grabbed. I grabbed one of them. If you paint the entire stud in dark, then you can just hit the top of it with your brush, and you essentially get an effect like you lined it without lining it. Give it dimension. It's easier. That's actually easier, Valandar, because you don't need perfect blends. You don't want it. You want a little bit of texture. I mean, are you on my Patreon? Did you see the PDF that I did? I did a PDF that showed how I started out with very defined, almost mirror effect on the breastplate here. But then I also showed how I fuzzed it out. I mean, all it is you're just not showing sharp detail on your NMM when you want it to be less... everything is less tight. Everything is more fuzzed out. There's more transitions between your shadow and your highlight. That's the only difference. It's actually much easier to not do Sky Earth or Chrome. When you're doing like a burnished surface instead of a super shiny surface, I mean, the only places you're going to hit hard definitions, like from highlight to shadow, are angles. She's coming along, Grace. No, you haven't been on my... Hold on, I've been doing the arm. 1 second. This will be the best piece I've ever done when I'm done with it, Bryce. Like, she definitely is better than Sacrifice. So the arm is coming along now. We started blocking in the hand without the colors. We've got that starting to be set up. I need to work more on the chainmail, which is really a pain in the butt. But the gauntlet... We set up the gauntlet highlights on my last stream on my own channel. And we fixed the forearm. So we're progressing. The metal is progressing. Don't know if she'll be done by ReaperCon. That's kind of the goal. Yeah. Thursdays at 4 p.m. Pacific. Or sorry, 2 p.m. Pacific. 4 p.m. Central. Just Thursday. To celebrate the end of my week. But yeah, it's cool. I show her often enough. But yeah, it's just like, Chrome is so much harder because you need to be precise with it and your blends need to be pretty tight. And you need to like have the understanding of where your environment is to really pull it off. But all you do with regular NMM and burnished surfaces and softer, more soiled surfaces is just fudge that more. NMM chainmail is like that chainmail, like a bust scale NMM chainmail is like ridiculously difficult to make look right. Like I had never done it at that scale. NMM at small scales at 28 mil is super easy because you're just fudging it. Like it doesn't require a lot of work. You really just are side brushing it and just like kind of, you know, painting it as a mass and do a wash or start, you know, I did a video on this too. It's super, super easy. But at a bust scale where it's actually each link is sculpted, then you're just like asking for trouble. after doing it on that model, I will be very not interested in doing it on any other model. Let's just put it that way. All right, let's see here. We were going to do some freehand. So I came up kind of just off the cuff of my head with a little freehand today. This morning, it hit me. I was like, she's a wizard, and I thought I kind of would like crescent moon designs on her. But then I thought I could actually show you guys how to fill out a simple design. So what we're going to do is we're going to do two inverted crescents. So, or one inverted and one up. And you're just going to do a little arc to start that out. And I'm using thinned paint so that I can easily touch it up. So we're going to start there, and then I think I'm going to go with a bigger crescent up here. And I'm going to actually... kind of mark where the horns of my crescent moon are going to be so that I can make sure they go out. I should have done that down here too. Make sure they go out kind of equally. So I didn't draw this design out or anything. It just kind of like hit my head and I was like, oh yeah, that could work. So when you're doing just like simple fill freehand, like you're going to do leaves and vines or you're going to do curlicues or stuff like tapestry work, start with a basic shape. Doesn't matter what shape it is. Could be a triangle, could be interlocking squares, could be, you know, a diamond shape. It doesn't matter. Just start from there, and then you're going to go out from there. Because if you're just doing fill work, like leaves and curlicues, you can just, like, kind of extemporaneize that. You don't need to plan it. Things like Celtic knotwork, you do need to plan. But even then, once you have, like, the knack of what's going on with that design, you can get it down so you can just work it. Well, Celtic knotwork is all math, so essentially, once you get the formula, once your brain really gets it, you can just go with it. But here, we're just going to do some simple embroidery. And I could choose to just start with these shapes. I can then decide, like, how I want to bring them out, if I want to make them actual moons, or if I just want to start with the line. Right, it's a little bit more than that, Mathophile, because, you know, you've got, like, the pretzel design that does specific over-unders, and you repeat it, and you shift, invert. I mean, there's all sorts of variation on it. And it's, once you've got it drawn out, it's easy. Then, yeah, it is over, under, over, under, after it, you know. But getting the math of the shapes right is hard for me because I'm not a math brain. Like, I was good at math, but I wasn't, like, yeah. Yeah, you're a mathophile, so you've got math brain. David doesn't find Celtic knotwork hard either, and he's also got a math brain. All right, so if I decide I want to do a real crescent moon, like, if I want to fill this in, I actually want, because right now it almost looks like a bowl or a chalice. So if I want to do a real moon, I think I've got to bring this up a little bit. Need to get a little more paint on my brush. Actually, I've got a little bit too much. But yeah, once you understand Celtic knotwork structure, you just, like, you know, go for it. But this is pure freehand here, where we're just going to experiment with expanding a simple design. Because this looked too blah for me. And I wanted something here. So now that I've got this thicker area, I can make sure that I've got my crescent moon. And again, I'm just going to, obviously it's lopsided right now, but that's okay. I have time and room. I am going to get out my Ritalic blue so that I can have my color to adjust it. You always want to have... There it is. You always want to have your background color mixed up so that you can correct parts where you go a little off script. So I'm going to mix up some Ritterlic so that I have that capability. And that's 9115, one of the most beautiful dark blues we do. I'm going to put a tiny touch of white in it. Because I believe that most of my surfaces here are slightly lighter. I grayed out my blue a little bit when I did this cape. So adding a little bit of white or my off-white is going to help it be closer to what I painted with. So then when I get a little bit outside of the lines, I just paint a little blue over it. Even if it isn't a perfect match for the blue that's under it, it's going to be good enough. Because the minute you add freehand to anything, any, like, small color problems or lack of matches, or slight disparities or unevenness of blending, all that just kind of disappears. Because freehand is a great disguiser. It's a great distractor. And I've got to decide if I'm going to keep the moon open or if I'm going to fill it in. Which entirely depends on how you want to do your design. I think my white's gotten actually a little bit too thin. The good thing about using paint that's so thin is it's very easy to paint over it and disguise it because the line is so faded. But if you want a stronger line, then it can be frustrating. So just tune it to what is in your comfort zone. But keeping it thin like this makes it very easy to paint over. It's never going to get chunky. It's going to be very easy to disguise. And I didn't draw a perfect half circle here. Nobody will. So you just kind of correct it in little bits. I've done this since I was a little kid drawing apples. Just draw something that looks circle-ish and then make your corrections. So we've got our crescent moon. Got our little, keep this, put that one a little bit further. That's good. I like that. All right. I think I want, now I have to kind of look at this. So on the bottom, I think I want more of this shape. I want it kind of almost to be sitting on, almost like it is a bowl. Kind of sitting on little feet. Yeah, there are people who can draw really good circles, but they're pretty rare. There was a kid in class who could draw better circle apples than me when I was in first or second grade. Yes, I actually have vivid memories of this. But I could draw everything else better than that person. They could draw a circle, but they couldn't draw a tiger. I could draw a tiger. So I believed that circles were overrated, and I still do. The ability to draw circles, anyway. All right, so now if I've got this and I've got that, I can decide if I want to kind of bring out. The easiest way to do it is just to kind of mimic the curves of things you've already got. And create a little freehand design. So since I did this kind of little thing with these angles down here, I'm going to do the same here. I'm going to create a little angle there and a little angle here. And you're just going to fill in your area. Just start filling in. And this doesn't match the initial concept that I was going to do, but it's kind of where my intuition guided me, so it's where I'm going. Remember, if you don't like it, you can always just paint over the whole thing blue and start again. It wasn't like it took me long to highlight this blue. One thing that I do want to do is I want to make sure that I underpaint. If I'm going to like fill in this area, I'm going to underpaint this highlight with white. I'm going to remind myself where my highlights are so that when I fill in with whatever color I'm going to fill in with, I will remember to highlight those areas. Makes it just a little easy to have a reminder. I mean, if you look at where your folds are, you should still know where to highlight them. But if you're not certain and you're panicked that you're going to cover up highlighting and you're not going to remember where to put it, just go ahead and paint over it with a little bit of white. All right, so let's make those little wing flanges kind of on the other side as well. People who know how to game the circle drawing system, I see. If at any point I decide I just don't like how this design is emerging, I'll just stop. But at this point, what it'll end up doing, if you just kind of start with one shape and work everything else off of it, is you will end up with a unique design. One that ideally fits the area that you are working on. I'm trying to think of what I want to do here. I think I want to do kind of another crescent, but almost like a double. Let's do this. And really all you're trying to do, this is doodling, guys. All you're doing at this point on the back of this model is you're doodling. So if you're a doodler already, if you like, you know, sit on the phone or, you know, listen to your podcasts and doodle and whatever, then you'll be good at this sort of freehand. So instead of just using a pencil or a pen, you are doodling with a brush and you are just trying to fill in an area in a way that you find pleasing. This is almost a shield shape. Maybe she's wearing a cloak of shielding. That's another thing you can do, is kind of think about what kind of magic item this could be and fill it in accordingly. So if I want it to look more like a shield, then I won't make it round all the way down like this. I'll actually cut it in and make it kind of peak toward the bottom like a shield would, or tends to, like we're familiar with the design of a shield. And of course, at this point, nothing is set in stone. You can absolutely back out, change any shape you want just by painting over it with your blue. You can stop and tune things, tighten them up. That's what I'll actually do right here now. So I'll take some of my dark blue, kind of tighten up some of these edges where I got a little rough, so I can see the design a little clearer. Because your lines are always going to be rough. They're always going to be sketchy when you're doing this. Unless you are like one of those perfect people who can just do these wonderful little lines. But in general, almost all of us are a little blurfy when we're sketching. So just accept your blurfiness and accept it as part of the process. Should always accept your blurfiness as part of the process. Often we forget that. To blurf is human. Just blurf and say, oh well, and fix it. So then we got a nice little shield shape there. Yeah, you could do that too. You could sketch that way, Valandar. The problem with the graphite, yeah, is that it does tend to repel certain mediums. That's why I got out of the habit. Although these days, less so, I think, depending on the medium. But like with colored pencil, because that has a high wax content, I don't usually sketch except very lightly. And I end up usually erasing it in bits. But as long as your medium of choice will go over the pencil without the pencil, without the graphite repelling the paint or the stuff, you're good. Once again, kind of, and this is where you also thin your lines up. If you want your lines to look really, really fine and impressive, you just paint in the blue to narrow them up. It's a lot easier than trying to draw tiny lines in the first place. White watercolor pencil? Yeah, makes sense. Watercolor pencil and colored pencils are highly compatible. And so it makes sense that since it's water-soluble, the binder is water-soluble, you could put acrylic paint over it with no problem. I just like to use paint. I'm just like, you know? I am, like, better, or I was better with a pencil at some point as far as drawing, but because I have used the brush for so many years, like, forced myself to use the brush, I just got better and better at fine detail with paint. Well, this isn't even that fine. I don't even know what... I'll probably put a sigil in the middle of that shield. I am going to add a little white to my paint puddle here, because this is a little bit too... just needs a little more strength. Yep, if you don't practice it, you'll never get better. You can read about it all day long, but in the end, you must sit down and paint. And you must just be at peace with the fact that you will screw up. You will blorf. We all do. You will blorf many times. You will emerge better because of it. Don't let it get you down. I mean, the only fail is stopping. I'm going to bring in a bit more of this. Now that I've got a stronger white, since I've done my sketch with a very, very lightweight paint, I can firm up my design now. Nice. Nice, probably. To blorf is human, it is. Yeah, while I was working my accounting job, I could do math in my head. So much easier. I can still beat David at that, like, although I'm rusty, so I'm not as good as I used to be, but sometimes I can still beat my math PhD boyfriend, because he was doing algorithms and not simple math, and I was doing simple math and accounting, so I can still do a lot of that in my head. And that was just practice. Alright, so I like that crescent. I like the little wings coming off. I like this needs to be neatened up a bit more. Yeah, what are numbers exactly? They're imaginary things. At least some of them are imaginary, or so I hear a mathophile. I do think it's funny that high-level mathematicians forget, like, just are not, like, often don't care about, like, basic math. Like, the actual functional math that we all need to get through the day, or to estimate a budget, or to add things. David could pull out the complex equations. Where my brain explodes. So if you look at it now, I'm also creating a shield shape around this whole thing, aren't I? Because I'm taking this line and bringing it all the way down. So then if I'm going to continue this shape, that means that my next set of lines should be down here to make the bottom of the shield. So when you're choosing shapes for freehand, try to be conscious of, like, the character of the freehand you're doing. Are you doing a lot of kind of points and curves? Then all of your lines should be points and curves. Are you doing a lot of squares, rectangular, blocky, angular thing, geometric designs? Then don't throw a curve in there, or it may look weird. You're doing a lot of, like, just straight up curving lines, like vines? Then try not to put anything too straight in. It'll look odd. And this is a good kind of design for this kind of soft, like, this is an asymmetrical design, because, you know, this side dips down more, this side's more up, but in general, it's the same shape. So all we did was kind of create a design to fill that space, and in this case to imply protection. I am very much enamored of the idea that it is like a cloak of protection, and that's why it has these sigils on it. So I think I'm gonna make kind of a cheat. And here, if you wanted to look for something to be in the middle of the little shield up here, you could look up, like, you could look up protection sigils from various cultures. Here, I'm just going to do a simple one based on Norse runes. It's an easy one because it's just the three-pronged. It's normally, like, totally... Normally this rune is a very simple rune. It's this, this, this. It's a very simple rune. But remember, I've got curvy lines here, not straight ones. So what I'm doing is I'm modifying this rune to make it more like a curve, like I've got in this moon, and then I'll put a stem down. So the key to, like, really cool freehand is finding a design that makes sense and then extrapolating from it to make it something more unique. Just like all creativity builds on the creative efforts that have gone before. And often it's just using an idea as a jumping off point and making it your own. So good freehand, I think, can be achieved by utilizing things that are in the world and recreating the design in tune with what you need. The melt table at Reaper is pretty cool, and there's a lot of good stuff on there. At ReaperCon, rather. Sorry. Concentrating on freehand. Not thinking. So then we've got the stock coming down there. We can make the bottom a little bit wider if we want. Again, to go with our design. And so we don't have lines that are too straight. It almost looks like a tree. Could look like an anchor. Could be all sorts of good connotations on this rough shape. And if I decided after I sketched that in that I didn't like it, I could just go back and wipe it out and start with something else. Again, you should never, like, nothing is set in stone until it's done. Interesting. Mostly is that you want to be consistent in a given design. If you're using curves, you should continue to use curves. If you're using a lot of straight angles, you should continue to use straight angles. This is applicable when you're extemporaneizing, like I am, like where you're just like kind of sketching as you go. So here, I'm gonna do more of this sort of thing. But even finer, so that I can get some even finer, smaller detail on here. And this is really relaxing and fun for me, because it is just like doodling. Like, And once again, I'm not, like, being super sharp here. I can come back in and make those look better. But I really like this design now. It's really coming together. And now that I've got that, what I think I'm going to do is kind of another variant on that down here, except I'm going to keep it, I'm going to make it more like an arrow, which is also a Norse rune. But I'm going to make it an upside down arrow. I'm going to curve it, make it come up the sides a little bit more. So when you can repeat a design but invert it, that's always nice. I won't go as tight with the freehand down here, so I won't go quite as fine or as small. I'll probably just do a couple of triangles, curved triangles. And here, we can connect these things. Because I had a loose line down there that I was not utilizing. So that's now more like it's coming up. And again, this white I've blocked in is just highlighting, just to remind me what I need to do. Although at this point, I think I probably would just like go with it because I can see my folds. Thanks, Marmondo. Yeah, we're working on it. I think that that's about it, though. Because I don't want to go... When you're getting into these uneven, bunchy places, you don't want to try to make those... Because they're not the same, you don't want to get into these folds up here as much. So I would probably stop here. As far as that design goes. And then we just refine it a little bit. And then next time we can fill it in. That went out a little bit too far on that one. Oh, thank you for the gifted sub there, Marmondo. Basement Forge, you are now a subscriber. Dun, dun, dun. Oh man, I freehanded right through Stretch Break. You just get in the zone because it's so relaxing to do this. It's just like, you're just like, yay, I'm filling in little patterns. And if I don't like it, I just paint a new one. And then I filled in little patterns until it was past stretch break. Right now, that highlight that I've gotten there kind of makes this look off center. Part of it is going to be tilted a little bit because this arm is higher than this arm, and thus the cloth is sculpted differently. So now, if I were to do more freehand than the lace, and the lace fits too because it's kind of a scalloped curved edge, so we're still like working with curved lines here. If I did decide to do a little bit of freehand down here, I could emulate that design. But this is very tied to, like I said, I feel like this is a protection cloak. So I think we're just going to keep that freehand there. I don't know that I'm going to do freehand down here now, because I do have freehand and tight detail up here. If I put freehand down here, it will distract the eye. Sometimes with a plain dress like this, you want to have that little pop of extra details. But in this case, the red is really beautiful the way it is right now. So any freehand that I put in on this lower edge is going to really reduce that, because I'm going to be knocking out some of these highlights. So that's why I've gone back and forth on whether I want to do freehand here. But the back of this cloak definitely needed freehand. So now it has the start of some freehand. Like I said, we need to color it in a bit. We need to decide if it's going to be gold, red, silver, all of the above. Probably red and silver. Maybe red and gold. I don't have a lot of gold on this model yet. I decided I wasn't really going in that direction. Wanted more high contrast because I took the leather so light. So probably the answer should be like silver and red. Maybe with a little bit of gold. I'm going to grab my blue and kind of outline, crisp up some of these design elements that I just kind of sketched in that are still a little wobbly. So just a little crisping up there with a little bit more of a solid white line. And again, when it gets a little messy, I can always... Oh, Armando, I don't remember. Quindy might know. The crystal was done a few sessions ago on this model, so several, a few weeks probably. It might be up on the YouTube. Because we did the crystal before we did the bottle. Up there, Quindy's got it for you, Marmundo. Quindy is our goddess, our resident goddess of linkage. It's actually very simple. And the crystal does not come on the model. This is a conversion. I just used some plastic card to carve a crystal. People were dubious, but it worked out. I didn't want anything too thick for the staff. And I thought plastic card would probably work. And actually, it's Julie's partner, Bob Rodolfi, if Julie's still in chat, who's responsible for that because he's inspired me with his plastic card usage. And I just was like, well, I need something that'll do sharp angles, and plastic card will do that if I use a knife on it. Because I remember Bob doing stuff with that, like with just showing how good of an angle you could get, so... I blame Bob Rodolfi. Awesome sculptor for Reaper. We are going to continue working a little bit here because these are a little bit different shaped or a little more squished than this one. We'll just pretty much work on refining this right up till our end time. And sometimes I'm going to wipe out a part and I'm going to like go, oh no, this isn't working, and I'm going to have to redraw it. None of these things are emergencies. It can be fun to cuss about at Paint Club though. Complain a lot about the awesome freehand you're doing. And how difficult it is. Just so people know, it's super hard and they should be impressed. So crisp those up. Now I'm going to bring in some. Good. Yeah, styrene is fun to work with. All right, so really fine line there to... separate these little freehand things, little freehand doodles. That's decent. This is kind of fuzzy up here, so I can crisp it up again by not taking the white in, but taking the blue in to define the edge there and create a little space here at the top. So you go back and forth. That's why it's nice to just pick two colors, a light and a dark, to kind of map in your freehand with. You can make it all nice and crisp. Get your design exactly the way you want to do it, and then gently paint it in. Well, the freehand definitely had some unbeautiful moments, Twistonoma. But if you want to know what I based, like, you know, based it around, then you should go back and watch the VOD. Yeah, I'm trying to make the... If you want a moon shape or a crescent shape to look more elegant, then make it slimmer. And I often will do that after the fact. Again, I'm just using my dark blue to kind of slim this line down and adjust it a little. And because I'm using just a really thin white paint, it's super easy to do that. Painting over it is a breeze. But yeah, freehand, I mean, freehand where you're just like, want something just doodly is easy. It's when you're trying to replicate something or imitate a painting or a design that somebody else has done that it can be difficult for you, because then you have limitations and shapes that you have to fit in and maybe some shapes you have to simplify. But when you're just trying to create a simple design, like I said, just start with a shape or two and work with it. For me, it was the crescents, the inverted crescents, and then I kind of worked out from there. And then once I realized it looks like a shield up here, I decided to embrace that for the whole thing. I do this kind of extrapolative freehand all the time. I find that it works really well. Like the halfling that I've been working on, you guys know that with her spades, her playing card spades design, a lot of time once I've got the spade down, I'm just kind of doodling some fun stuff around it to make it more interesting and a little more elaborate. Again, the more I like it, the more I can just bring it in really nice and bold so that everything shows up, and then it'll be very much easier to paint colors over it when I come back to it. That one went a little bit close and a little bit too weird. Any intermediate classes? Actually, Marmondo, if you go, I think it might be free. If you go to my Patreon, which is patreon.com/paintingbig, I think I've got a PDF up there under public. It should be just free. About the techniques and the order to learn them in. So essentially it starts with just, you know, doing good smooth base coats, then it goes to washes, and it goes to, you know, like layering and wet blending, and it goes to lining and, you know, all that sort of thing. But it kind of outlines kind of the basic toolbox techniques that you need as a mini painter. So if you look at that handout, then you should be able to say, oh, well, I already can do really good base coating and I already know how to do lining, but I'm not very good at layering, so maybe I should work on that next. That sort of thing. And it's just my conceptualization of the techniques, so other instructors may feel that they need a different, like, order or significance or weight. But really it just serves as kind of a good conceptual and mechanical techniques of mini painting. Like, and if you're like, oh, well, I kind of get highlighting and shading, but I've never tried glazing, you know, that kind of thing, then that would be the next thing for you to work on. That sort of thing. But in general, you want to be able to do a smooth, neat base coat. Or you can embrace the artistic side and do a messy, wild, but still pretty cool base coat. You need to get to a base coating style one way or another. If you're a beginner, though, I recommend going neat first and messy second. But James Wapple would disagree with me, so... Either way, You know, there are certain techniques like lining, like layering, which is putting thin paint over already dried paint to create the illusion of a blend. Like wet blending, which is smooshing two colors together on the model. I don't know what level you're at. So, like, if you're at the base coat, dry brush, wash level, there's also the Reaper Learn to Paint kits, which Rhonda does. And so her first one is the base coat, wash and highlight. But the second one is layering. So if you feel like you already have your basic techniques up, pretty much down, Murmundo, then you could check out the Layer Up kit on Reaper's Learn to Paint kits. And she teaches layering and glazing with that kit. James is an anomaly, but I like to mention it because he does have a point. I mean, there was a kid I taught once. It was the kid who I taught who entered Youth Golden Demons and got silver. He was 11. Layering was just not for him. He was just too wild of a painter. But wet blending, he took to it like, seriously, like a duck to water. And he ended up winning a silver demon. He liked wet blending his base coats, like doing shadow, midtone, highlight all in one thing and then just detailing. So I have to mention it because it's not just Wapple. There are definitely people out there who don't do well under tight constraints and are much more comfortable with a loose approach. And you can make it work on miniatures. So I always like to kind of caveat when I say that layering is probably more integral of a technique than wet blending, and that getting a smooth, neat base coat is, you know, your first priority. Because sometimes if it's not working for you, you could try to do something else. And it would be perfectly valid. I think Alfonso is another one who would probably say that being wild with your base coat, especially on larger models, can lead to good things. So, yeah. It's hard when you start out really regimented and tight, though, right, Bryce? Like, I am, obviously. Here is the pinnacle of tight painting. Like, I love technical detail and tight painting. So that's it. When I did Troll was my attempt at Wapple Alfonso, you know, more free painting, and it was fun, but I don't know that I would use it on a model that didn't have a lot of like a lot of skin and fur and leather, you know, like areas where I could be loose and it'll look good and maybe even give me textural artifacts to use. Oh, it's time to wrap this up. Thanks, Quindy, for the link to the Learn to Paint kits. And if you do go to my Patreon and you get that thing and you're like, what is glazing? Just come back and ask. This stream, as I said yesterday, is really all about answering your questions, and we just kind of paint stuff when you guys don't have questions. So don't ever feel like you cannot interrupt the stream with a question. The only time it won't work for you is if we're right at the end, or if you ask me such a question that could essentially take up a stream all on its own. Then I might kind of look at you and go, bad timing. Or too complicated of a question. Try to break your question down. Like, how do you do transparent glass effects is a bad question. Where do you put your highlights on a round glass bottle is a much easier question. The one I can answer in 5 or 10 minutes. The other would take, you know, an entire stream to paint one. You wouldn't think that necessarily if you watched me do it while I was here, Dogfather, because it's really just like filling in shapes with doodles. If you doodle and you enjoy doodling, you can do this sort of freehand. Let's call it extrapolative freehand. Because you're really just starting with a simple shape, like in this case, a crescent moon and then another crescent. And then you're playing with it. And then once you have something you like, you're just neatening it up. And then it looks like you meant to do this all along, when in reality, when I started painting this today, I had an entirely different, like, concept of where it would go. But if you're open to changing your mind and just following where the model leads, then you can do this sort of thing. And if you want to make it even more complex, the only thing you're doing is filling in even more tiny detail. So if I wanted to make this more complex, one area I could add detail would be right in here. I could just put a little bit of an insert. like a leaf. And then I could do the same on the other side. And that's going to be controlled by your, you know, limited by your brush control, obviously. Like how much of fine work you can add to make a design look really, really... complex. But this sort of thing is, it creates an illusion of complexity that you didn't even, you know, you weren't even concepting when you started it. Like, it just kind of happened. I got a little bit too long on that one on the left. Yeah. James is a pro, though. I keep telling you guys. James has 40 years of, like, at a guess, maybe more. I don't know how young he started. But, you know, given my age and how long I've been doing it, he has a lot of time being a pro 2D painter and then adapting that to miniatures. So, nothing James does surprises me because I know how long he's been doing art. And it's, you just get this, especially when you go multimedia like he does, or he's, you know, very familiar with oils before he even came into the mini painting hobby. So then he just had to figure out, how can I apply this medium I love to these tiny little things and make it work, right? There, that's going to make it a little bit sharper. That's almost like two little eyes there. I like that. So I'm actually going to carry that line up a little bit more. That's pretty. I like that. I might do another set actually in the crescent here. So the more, the bottom line is, the more little tiny detail you fill in every gap you see, the tighter and finer and more intricate your design will appear. Fold distortion? Well, this is really flat. Like, this is why this is a great surface trash for this, but you can see that I'm carrying the shield line, like, into this fold on the side here. And it looks, you know, it still looks okay from the front. It's a little bit compressed. I wouldn't carry a design up into this area precisely because of folds. When you start seeing deep folds that you can't actually paint into, like here, the fold is shallow enough that I have no problem painting into it. And even though it does distort the crescent a little bit, as you can see, it kind of distorts that horn right there. This shape is still intact. So ideally, if you're going to paint something over deeper folds, you don't choose a design at all like this. This sort of doodle is good against when you can reach inside all the folds. And then you just paint it. Like, you just tilt the model and keep painting it. And the fold distortion will appear naturally because the folds themselves will suggest it when you look at it from a certain angle. Just like up here, I just painted the crescent exactly like I painted the crescent over here. I just adjusted it. You know, I just painted it into the fold. And now when I turn it, the fold takes care of the distortion all on its own, like it would in fabric. So I would not do anything like this. If you've got a thing with deep folds, you have two choices. You can do a big, broad, very large design that's still going to carry across the folds. Or you can do a tiny design that's repetitive. That's going to essentially, enough of the design is going to appear on the top of each fold that you can carry the design. That your viewer will get it and it will look right. Tartans are a good example of that. Because as long as you've got a good clear section, one good clear section to show the colors and the design of the tartan, then little pieces of tartan can show up on other folds and it won't matter. It'll still look right. So, I mean, the bottom line is, before I even start painting a design, I'm going to look at what kind of surface I'm on. Like Templar, the design I use on her is going to be so much different than this design. Because of this fold, this overlapping cloth here, there's a deep fold here that overlaps here. So I'm going to have to think about that. There's deep folds up here. So when I go to paint her design, it's going to be based on that. Like, I have to choose a design that will translate well to this surface. So always consider the surface that you're painting on. Same back here. Look at all these deep folds. It's going to be a very different design that I do back there than I do here. So you always got to look at the surface and judge. Alrighty, what we did today, we highlighted her hair, we gave her a little disapproving stare eyeballs, we blocked in our staff a little bit, and we, oh, and I totally didn't paint the blue on the back of that, I need to get it, and we did cool freehand, this is the start, this is what I call mapping in freehand, and then you go back in, and you add color, and maybe texture, depending on the scale. You can add more texture if you are at, a bust scale, and usually you're just adding just design elements and lighting when you're at the 28 millimeter scale. You bet, guys. It was fun. Like I said, I really like this model. Oh, yay, it's Crow's Nest. Oh, Sadie is the guest today. Wow. That should be fun. So, yeah, so for those coming in, this is Vonsley Orc Wizard 3721. She's a great model. I hope you all run out and buy one. And tomorrow we'll work on Mushroom Queen, Evil Wicked Mushroom Queen. I was thinking about her the other yesterday, so we'll see what we can do. But yeah, no problem. And you guys have a great day, and yeah, I'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.